right then. So we're going to move on. And I think this is important to a lot of us. It doesn't matter if you're school-aged or not. It's about the future of our country, right? And there's been a lot of angst about the new cabinet member who is the Secretary of Education under the President Trump's administration. Her name is Betsy DeVos. And she's a very controversial figure, very controversial. And my next guest is going to tell us why that is so, as of a myriad of other issues that are going on in education today. I'm one of these people that say these for-profit colleges are some of the most misleading and lethal scams in this country. Very few does it work for, like a regular accredited college education. And people are getting the shaft left and right. We can address that. We're also going to talk about Common Core. I don't know if a lot of us understand what Common Core is, other than you have people that say it's a disaster. You know, there was a time where public schools actually worked in this country. And I think that they still work for a select few. It's all about resources. So my next guest is David Kim. David founded C2 Education, the nation's leading test prep tutoring and college counseling organizations. He's a graduate of Harvard University. He started C2 out of his college dorm room 20 years ago and has built C2 Education into more than 230 locations across the U.S. David Kim, welcome to the program. How are you?
Yeah, good morning, Perry. How are you?
Happy
Valentine's Day.
Dan, same to you. So, David, I'm interested. Tell me what your organization actually does and how it got into 230 locations around the country.
Yeah, Perry, I mean, what we do is we have a fundamental belief that, you know, education is the vehicle through which, you know, families can achieve the American dream. And so what we offer are services that really help educate parents and students on how do you apply for colleges, you know, what do you need to do to prepare yourself, whether it's in middle school or high school, in terms of coursework, in terms of interest, and really set yourself up for success so that you not only get into your dream college, but also once you get there, you're able to pay for it and able to graduate successfully and really accomplish, you know, something, you know, bigger and better with, you know, your child's life.
So let's talk about this. Let's address it from the very beginning. Head Start, Detroit public schools, the lack of interest in these schools, no value into these students. Same thing here in Chicago and other urban cities around the country where you have a strong black and brown population. What you're talking about sounds ideal if you live in Naperville or Evanston, but what about the people that come from distressed communities? Do you have any emphasis or do you have anything that has to, you know, do you do anything to consult in terms of public policy of how people should get a fair education? Or maybe you don't think people should get a fair education around the country, that they should be funded by the tax dollars that they live in. Where are you on this kind of particular issue?
Yeah, well, I fundamentally believe, you know, that education is important to all people, right? I mean, it's the vehicle through which, you know, we can gain, you know, better opportunities. And at the end of the day, you know, education has really been positioned, you know, in this country as a very meritocratic system. And so, you know, being able to have, you know, the right resources and the right programs, you know, for all individuals, whether you, you know, are in, you know, a lower socioeconomic area versus a more affluent area, I think is important. I think the whole issue of education, you know, that we fail to have a proper discussion on is that it's very complex, right? And the needs of those in impoverished areas, whether it's in the inner cities or in rural communities, will be very different from some of your middle and upper middle class families in some of the suburbs you name, like in a Naperville or in Evanston, where we have C2 education centers as well. So really thinking about all the complexity and the variables that are there, I think is something that a lot of policymakers, who are politicians, fail to discuss and recognize, and those who are more qualified and more academically oriented, probably talk about it, but don't have as big a megaphone from which to really discuss how challenging it really is.
Tell me why, and I know, but I'm sure some listeners, they're very acquainted with the name Betsy DeVos. I know that the unions around the nation, teachers unions and others, have been very vociferous in their disdain for Betsy DeVos. Tell us a little bit what their fears are, and who is Betsy DeVos?
Yeah, I mean, I think, having seen the first 30 days of the current president's administration, I think, concerns and worries should only be more magnified. I mean, we recently obviously had one of his National Security Council member resign this morning.
Right.
And so when you look at Ms. DeVos, some of the controversy, surrounding her is, does she have deep knowledge, deep expertise, and competency to run, the Department of Education? I'll be honest with you. I mean, she's been confirmed, so I do hope the best for her. So that's one facet that where I think you had a few individuals from the other side of the aisle kind of come against kind of her nomination. The other area is that she's a huge advocate of charter schools, and so she comes from a very wealthy family.
She's never been inside of a public school. Her kids have never been. Her husband have never been inside of a public school.
I want to put that against her. I mean, I think, her heart, she wants to do, what's best and right in her mind. But, even if you only had a private school education, really educating yourself on what's really going on in the schools, obviously is extremely important to be able to do, her job correctly. I mean, she has to help the entire country, not just a very, localized constituency of individuals.
And so tell me why Betsy DeVos is such a proponent for charter schools. Is it the whole idea of school choice? What is it about, because she's a billionaire, she's a philanthropist, but some of her policies has disturbed individuals. And when we come back from the break, you can tell me what some of those policies that she is espousing that is so abhorrent to the unions, particularly the Chicago teachers unions and, the national teachers education unions. What is it? Because I want to be fair, to who she is, just because I'm not a big proponent of charter schools. I think that they should exist, but I think there should be some limitations. I want to know, what is it about Betsy DeVos that they find so repugnant? All right, then, we're talking to David Kim. He founded C2 Education. Stay with us. My guest is David Kim. We've been talking about education, and I've got a phone call, but about C2, and that's Willie on the line. Hi, Willie. How are you?
How you doing, Perry?
I'm well.
Wonderful. I just wanted to talk about C2 for a minute, because my daughter, who was in seventh grade and in a Catholic school, was way behind in math.
Mm-hmm.
She took the ACT. She's brilliant. She got a 24. Then we sent her to the tutoring place.
Mm-hmm.
They raised her score 10 points. She ended up with a 34 on the ACT.
Wow.
They even gave her a scholarship because I was out of a job at the time.
Right.
And now she's going to the number one school in the country, Phillips Exeter. And she was struggling at first. She was struggling, but they taught her how to recover.
Is that a prep school, Phillips Exodus?
It's a private school, and she lives there.
And where is it, out east?
It's in New Hampshire.
It's in New Hampshire. Wow.
And so she was, and here are a couple things real quick, what's important. When she took the ACT, she told me she was the only black kid in the entire room taking the ACT at the time.
Wow.
And that these other kids have other advantages that we knew nothing about. Mm-hmm. And without this tutoring program, because she was way behind in math.
Right.
Without that program, she wouldn't have gotten that extra 10 points.
That is incredible.
I mean, we're getting college letters because they think she's older than what she is because of her score. These are the things that black kids aren't doing that we need to get them doing. They need to be taking these tutoring programs. We need to find funding for them to go. That's how this gets better.
Well, why isn't David Kim the education secretary? David? If you have these kind of successes, why aren't you the education secretary?
Well, you know, I'm not as politically active as maybe I should be, but you know, we try to have a great product, and I really appreciate the story that Willie shared here about his daughter, and a 10-point increase in ACT is actually really amazing to see, especially at that age, and you know, the fact that she's at, you know, one of the top private schools, you know, it's a great way to start my morning, and hopefully you know, she'll have continued success over at Exeter and whatever university that she ends up going to, but you know, hearing that is extremely extremely gratifying. But you know, back to your point, I mean, the way we run our programs, you know, Perry, is, you know, the whole aspect of counseling and providing knowledge to both the parent and student is extremely extremely important, right?
And is that what you do a concentration on? You make sure that the parents are as involved in with the student and understand, you know, what you're trying to accomplish. There's got to be a lot of hands-on from both parties, the child as well as the parents.
Absolutely. I mean, we meet with parents on a monthly basis. What we try to do with the student or the parent, you know, reiterate what their goals are, you know, really open up what the whole world looks like. You know, what is it, you know, if you're looking at some things within, you know, Chicago, within the state of Illinois, mm-hmm. you know, within a certain geography, or if you're looking for something even bigger, you know, really being able to, you know, provide that information, I think is key. I think, you know, number two, you know, we really try to set up our learning programs kind of more in a mentorship type program, so mm-hmm. that, you know, the students get to work with a young, you know, man or woman who's really accomplished a lot himself or herself academically, mm-hmm. really have a conversation to kind of engage their curiosity, engage their interest, so, you know, that they stay motivated. I mean, when you're working with young people, it's not just enough to have great books, great programs. You know, that inspiration is absolutely important to kind of keep them going, because there's so many distractions day in, day out, you know, whether it's, you know, music or movies or friends. I mean, you name it. And then when we talk about, you know, kind of, you know, the other issues that are occurring in, you know, poorer neighborhoods,
right,
you know, where you have crime, where you have, you know, people, you know, who aren't working and just struggling to, you know, put food on the table, you know, those are additional stressors that, you know, that one would have to really think about, you know, in terms of really, you know, fixing, you know, kind of the public education system as we see it today. I mean, it's complex. I mean, it involves transportation, it involves jobs, it involves, you know, safety. You know, there's so many buckets, you know, that you really need to, you know, properly address if you're going to make this thing shine.
All right, so Willie's has me intrigued. His stories was just great. So C2, so you're in different locations. When you say different locations, are you in a strip mall? What, I mean, how do people use C2 services?
Yeah, so we're in smaller centers, so sometimes we're in office buildings, sometimes we're in a strip center, you know, that's easily accessible for families and students, you know, because we understand, you know, kind of the necessity to have a convenient place, and the students come in,
okay.
and they'll typically come in anywhere 2 to 3 times a week, meet with a tutor, meet with our counselor, and stay with us anywhere from 4 to 12 months. But, you know, that high touch, you know, makes a huge impact. You know, the problem is, you know, how do you have a high-touch program like that, you know, for public education? And it becomes challenging, right, because, you know, dollars and cents, you know, are a resource that are unlimited, unfortunately. And so how do you come up with a program that can really address, you know, a classroom of 20 or 30 students, you know, in just as an effective manner? And so, you know, we really kind of set ourselves apart in getting really, I think, exemplary results, because we recognize that students are very different, needs are very different, and approaches have to be really customized, you know, at the end of the day. And so I know personally that's not necessarily applicable to the school system. So.
Okay. Like I said, I'm really intrigued about this, and I'm sure that there are other listeners who are who, because whenever we talk about education and we know something that works, rather be in different programs like aviation or something, they get involved. So off the top of your head, do you have any locations in the Chicago area?
Oh yeah, we have many. I mean, we have one in the city right around the kind of Lincoln Park area. Obviously in the suburbs, you know, we kind of mentioned that you mentioned some of the towns like Naperville, Evanston, you know, Schaumburg. You know, we're predominantly in the suburbs, you know, just because our main demographic, you know, because it is private pay,
right?
You know, there aren't public funds available for this, unfortunately. You know, it's predominantly where we are.
And that's great that you offer the scholarships, but that's the problem. It's because, like Willie was saying, his child was the only one, only black child taking the ACTs. All we want is to have an equal footing so that everybody can express the, you know, have the American dream. And it's just, it just seems a little unfair to people who are not lucky like Willie to be able to send his child there. But there are mothers, because all mothers, they all want the same thing when it comes to their children. So where do people go? Is there a website that they can go to and find out where
there is a website.
Okay.
So our website is www.c2, that's the letter C, number 2, educate, educate.com. You know, they can, you know, there's a lot of information on the site. There's webinars that you can sign up for free if you're interested in the college admissions process, if you're interested in, you know, the ACT or SAT, what they're used for. You know, we do provide a lot of free informational services. We do, you know, seminars at public libraries. We typically have teamed up with the National Association of College Admission Counselors. So when they were there last September, I spoke, you know, over there in downtown Chicago as well at the convention center.
Okay.
So we do a lot of things there to really, you know, at least educate families to know, you know, what is out there. Obviously, in terms of, you know, utilizing our services, you know, if their school, so we typically give our scholarships directly to the counselors. Who can kind of determine who might benefit best from it. You know, if their school doesn't have that, then obviously a lot of it is private pay. But back to Willie's point earlier, and I think the issue with the charter schools, you know, is that it's great to give people the choice to, you know, in theory, hey, I can go to, you know, another school, or I can use my money, you know, for tutoring. But, you know, there is a lack of oversight. And so you see kind of the quality of, you know, whether it's after-school tutoring programs like ourselves, mm-hmm. whether it's charter schools, and then you were alluding to kind of the for-profit colleges,
mm-hmm.
You know, that lack of oversight really results in having a mixed bag in terms of quality, and that's where the theory of choice really breaks down. I mean, I think, you know, choice in a market-driven capitalistic society, everybody wants to be able to say, hey, I have the choice of what food I eat or what clothes I buy or what car I drive. You know, that theoretically makes a lot of sense, but, you know, if you don't have the right regulations to really mandate,
mm-hmm.
You know, a choice amongst great programs, you know, then that's where it fails, and that's where you saw it fail in Detroit, and where you see a lot of the criticism, you know, that the current, you know, Secretary of Education, Mr. Loss, is being thrown at, is that, you know, she kind of, you know, provided a lot of money and a lot of lobbying towards, you know, kind of the charter school movement. But, you know, there was, you know, no oversight in these schools. And a lot of these schools at the end of the day were much worse than the public schools that, you know, in terms of their offering. So.
All right. Well, listen, David, it was really nice meeting you, David Kim. And I'm very impressed in the fact that you started this in your dorm room at Harvard. Is this all you do now, or what else do you do? What'd you get your degree in?
So I studied economics. I actually studied a lot on how effective charter schools were. It was kind of the thing that I looked at. I actually saw 17 years ago that the results were actually very inconclusive, and that's why I came up with this concept of C2. And I think there's a lot of other great concepts out there that we should look to mimic. I mean, in closing, I mean, I think there's some programs, I don't know if it's really kind of Jeffrey Cannata over in Harlem doing the Harlem Children's Zone, you know, really
right.
providing kind of this counseling and, you know, inspiration and modeling you know, from a very young age, is very important. I mean, it's important to understand, you know, what's possible and what are the things that we should strive to do. And so really having kind of those mentors, you know, that are within the community that are able to really, help young people see those things, I think is extremely important. And that's where our model is at C2 is somewhat modeled on, is that, you know, we need to have, individuals that can be, those role models for young people, not only teaching them, you know, the skills, but also teaching them, how to study, how to manage your time, you know, how to, you know, become more curious, how to become more independent as an individual and really take ownership of your life at the end of the day. So it's really preparing young people to become, you know, really, you know, exemplary adults and really be able to achieve whatever they put their mind to.
All right. Job, let me just say this, David. Job well done. Thank you so much for joining us today. And I'm going to be, when we have these other education issues, I'm going to be hitting you up. So I hope I can call on you again sometime.
I appreciate it, Perry. Anytime.
All right, then. It's 11:35 on the Talk of Chicago. So let's talk about this. Let's address it from the very beginning. Head Start, Detroit Public Schools, the lack of interest in these schools, no value into these students. Same thing here in Chicago and other urban cities around the country where you have a strong black and brown population. What you're talking about sounds ideal if you live in Naperville or Evanston, but what about the people that come from distressed communities? Do you have any emphasis, or do you have anything that has to, you know, do you do anything to consult in terms of public policy of how people should get a fair education? Or maybe you don't think people should get a fair education around the country, that they should be funded by the tax dollars that they live in. Where are you on this kind of particular issue?
Yeah, well, I fundamentally believe, you know, that education is important to all people, right? I mean, mm-hmm. it's the vehicle through which, you know, we can gain, you know, better opportunities. And at the end of the day, you know, education has really been positioned, you know, in this country as a very meritocratic system. And so, you know, being able to have, you know, the right resources and the right programs, you know, for all individuals, mm-hmm. whether you know, are in a lower socioeconomic area versus a more affluent area, mm-hmm. I think is important. I think the whole issue of education, you know, that we fail to have a proper discussion on, mm-hmm. Is that it's very complex, right? And the needs of those in impoverished areas, whether it's in the inner cities or in rural communities,
right.
Will be very different from you know, some of your middle and upper middle, you know, class families in some of the suburbs you name, like in a Naperville or in Evanston, where,
right.
you know, we have, you know, C2 education centers as well. So,
mm-hmm.
You know, really thinking about, you know, all the, you know, complexity and the variables that are there, you know, I think is something that, you know, a lot of policymakers, you know, who are politicians fail to discuss and recognize. And those who are more qualified and more academically oriented,
right.
you know, probably talk about it, but don't have as big a megaphone from which to really, you know, discuss, you know, how challenging, you know, it really is.
Tell me why, and I know, but I'm sure some listeners, they're very acquainted with the name Betsy DeVos. I know that the unions around the nation, teachers unions and others, have been very vociferous in their disdain for Betsy DeVos. Tell us a little bit what their fears are, and who is Betsy DeVos?
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, having seen the first 30 days of the current president's administration, I think, you know, concerns and worries should only be more magnified. I mean, we recently obviously had one of his National Security Council member resign this morning.
Right.
And so when you look at Ms. DeVos, some of the controversy, you know, surrounding her is, you know, does she have deep knowledge, deep expertise and competency to run, you know, the Department of Education. I'll be honest with you. I mean she's been confirmed, so I do hope, you know, the best for her. But thank goodness, you know, she's very, you know, low in line in terms of the presidential succession if anything were to happen,
mm-hmm.
Because, you know, the country would probably not, you know, be in a very good shape, you know, with, you know, kind of leadership, you know, that she has so far demonstrated in some of the hearings and some of the, and, you know, the things that she's replied to when asked, you know, very, I would say, basic policy questions regarding education. So that's one facet that where I think, you know, you had, you know, a few individuals from the other side of the aisle kind of come against, you know, kind of her nomination. You know, the other area is that, you know, she's a huge advocate of charter schools, and so, you know, she comes from a very wealthy family.
She's never been inside of a public school. Her kids have never been. Her husband have never been inside of a public school.
I want to put that against her. I mean, you know, I think, you know, her heart, you know, she wants to do, you know, what's best and right in her mind. But, you know, even if you only had a private school education, you know, really educating yourself on what's really going on in the schools obviously is extremely important, you know, to be able to do, you know, her job correctly. I mean, she has, you know, she has to help the entire country, not mm-hmm. just a very, you know, localized constituency of individuals.
And so tell me why Betsy DeVos is such a proponent for charter schools. Is it the whole idea of school choice? What is it about, you know, because she's a billionaire, she's a philanthropist, but yeah. some of her policies has disturbed individuals. And when we come back from the break, you can tell me what some of those policies that she is espousing that is so abhorrent to the unions, particularly the Chicago teachers unions and, you know, the national teachers education unions. What is it? Because I want to be fair, you know, to who she is, just because I'm not a big proponent of charter schools. I think that they should exist, but I think there should be some limitations. I want to know, what is it about Betsy DeVos that they find so repugnant? All right, then we're talking to David Kim. He founded C2 Education. Stay with us.